Hello everyone, and welcome to this week's tutorial, and a special hello to all of my new subscribers this week. For this week's tutorial, we're working on these overnight oats in a mason jar. The materials I used are M. Graham watercolors, and I'll talk about the colors as we go throughout the tutorial. I used Arches Rough 140-pound watercolor paper, a number 6, a number 2, and a number 1 round brush, and then for all of the tiny details, I used a really small brush, a number 10-0 round. For the drawing, I used a Prismacolor Colorace pencil, and I used it in gray. I also used a Staedtler eraser and a Papermate Tough Stuff eraser stick. Since I did the drawing right on the watercolor paper, these are really gentle erasers to use. If you're curious about any of the materials that I used, including the individual colors used in this painting, I will have them all linked in the description box down below. Now for the first glaze, we are going in really light, and for the bottom portion of these overnight oats, I used a mixture of yellow ochre and just the tiniest bit of dioxazine violet. I wanted it to be a really muted color. If you're using a yellow ochre that maybe has a slightly cooler tone to it, then you probably won't need to do this. For the berries up top, I used Quin Rose, Anthraquinone Blue, and for the blackberries, I used a mixture of both of them. And then for the peanut butter, I used a slightly stronger mixture of my yellow ochre and dioxazine violet that we used down below. And I'm just going in and I'm making sure to do these layers really light. I want to be able to preserve all of the highlights that I can, so you can see that I'm leaving areas of white for the really hot highlights, and I'm making sure to leave a layer that will be kind of like that mid-tone color. Then I also went in and just added a little bit more detail to the top of the mason jar. For the outside of the jar, I'm going in with a little bit of my Anthraquinone Blue, and I'm doing a really light layer since I want this to just kind of appear to be glass or see-through, and I'm doing a more illustrative look to this. I'm just going through and kind of adding that base layer. We're going to add a lot of details later on. And then for the top portion of these oats, I'm going in with a really thin mixture of my burnt sienna. And again, I'm just making sure to leave those highlights. Now for the top portion of the mason jar, I'm making sure to do that a little bit lighter than everything that's sticking out of the top. I wanted to really show that this area was behind glass. So even though it may not be completely realistic, that was something that I wanted to do. And then for some of the areas in the top of the mason jar, I'm going in with a darker mixture of the Anthraquinone Blue, and you can see that I'm doing that around the bottom as well, just adding in some lines that follow the curvature of the jar. And then for these small kind of air bubbles in the top portion, I'm going in with a mixture of sepia and a little bit of purple just to really get that depth in there. And then for the bottom portion of the jar where I am kind of creating that harsher shadow around the outside of it, I'm going in with the same mixture of yellow ochre and dioxazine violet, but I did add a little bit more violet to really bump up those shadows. And then while that dries, I'm going in and I am darkening up the top portion of my overnight oats. And as you can see, that I am making sure that the right side is staying darker than the left side. And I'm leaving this lighter area kind of just off center so that you can see that this is in a jar and there is this natural highlight there. And I'm going in and I'm doing the same thing at the bottom with my mixture of yellow ochre and dioxazine violet. And now you can see I'm going in and around the blueberries, I am doing a really dark area around the bottom, kind of like these little C-curves, and then blending it upward so that the light always looks like it's coming down on the top of the blackberries. And I'm going in and I'm adding some detail to the top portion of the jar, and I'm trying to make that a little bit lighter than the bottom portion, the berries and everything that are sticking out of the top. And I'm just kind of adding some details where it's going to be darker and having these areas that are a little bit lighter to kind of show the highlights in the top of the jar. And then for these small little air pockets in the bottom portion of the overnight oats, it is my same mixture, but again, more of the dioxazine violet. So it will look like they are in really heavy shadow. And you're gonna see a lot of me just kind of going back and forth and darkening up these areas. For the top portion of the jar where I have the darker, more chocolatey portion of it, you will see that I started adding a little bit of my dioxazine violet, and that really started to richen up that area and darken it and create a really realistic shadow without having to get another color. And the peanut butter that's sticking up out of the top, I'm just adding a little bit of my burnt sienna to like the chocolate pieces that are up on top. And the peanut butter, you'll see that I am painting it, but I ended up not liking it, so I just went in with a scrubber brush and I fixed it with that, and it created just this really nice highlight and depth that I really just accidentally stumbled into. So that might be something that you can look into. Just paint it and then maybe scrub out some of it or paint around the edges and blend inward. And now I'm going in and I am increasing the shadows and the depth on the outside of the jars and around the bottom of the jar. And again, going in and darkening some of the areas of the berries, and I'm adding a lot to the outside, and the more I go with these layers or glazes, the less I'm blending that out to really increase the shadows and the depth in those. And then for the outside of the jar, I'm using more of my anthraquinone blue, and I'm also using little bits of Payne's gray. I mixed in some turquoise along the way, some dioxazine violet, and I also made sure to work in the colors that were in the overnight oats jar so that you can kind of see the reflections of what is in there. Since if you're looking at glass, you will see those reflections. So to work in a little bit of that yellow ochre and dioxazine violet mix really helped to create a more realistic look all the way around. And then up at the top, I'm really making sure to add a lot of depth and shadow to the top part of the mason jar. And I'm using a lot of the same colors. I'm making them a little bit darker. I do kind of wish that maybe I had held off a little bit and made them lighter, but I think it still worked out in the end. And I'm leaving a lot of white space up there for the natural reflections that are going to be there. And I also wanted to make sure to leave some white space so that I could work in those reflections of the objects that are inside of the jar as well, because you want those colors to be there. Now, this isn't the most realistic way to do this. It's certainly a little bit more illustrative, and if you wanted it to be more realistic, then you can follow these steps, but really paying close attention to your reference image and how it reflects those colors, because a lot of the time, I can't for the life of me think of what those are called, the little grooves in the top. They're going to really show the colors that are behind it, and they're going to elongate them in some cases. So keep that in mind if you are painting this or painting something similar to this along with me. And you can see that I'm just going in and I'm darkening some of those. With the pink berries, I'm going in and in some cases I'm adding a little bit of permanent alizarin crimson just because I wanted to really, really bump up those shadows. And similarly to the blueberries, I add a little bit of Payne's gray later on so that I could really, really exaggerate the depth and color of those berries and to create a lot of contrast. And now you can see I'm going in and I'm taking my really, really fine brush. This isn't anything special. I got it in one of those absurd packs of like 25 brushes or something like that. So I'm not even sure what brand it is. But I'm just going in and I am outlining the berries. Again, this isn't the most realistic way that you can do it, but considering the size of this painting, it is a good way to kind of simplify those shapes. And you want to be able to identify the individual segments of those berries. And now for the bubbles down below, I'm going in and I'm adding more of my yellow ochre and dioxazine violet mixture. And I'm starting to add some depth around the outside and kind of blend it in. So you can kind of see this depth in the air pockets that are in there. And here I am going back to those air bubbles and using the same mixture and that same technique of adding really stark shadows to the bottom left-hand side of those air bubbles, and I'm kind of blending it out, but also making sure to leave a little bit of texture in there because you're going to see light reflecting off of these areas, and not all of them are perfect. This is kind of a weird mix that you have there, so it's not going to be completely smooth like it would be with some other things. And that was how I made it look more realistic in the end. And I'm going in and just kind of reinforcing the depth that I had created in the blackberries up top, and in this layer I also went and kind of blended that out a little bit, and you can see that at this point it really started to exaggerate those shadows in all of the berries. And here you can see I'm going in with the Payne's gray and the blueberries. And again, in all of these layers, I'm making sure to leave those really hot highlights in them to make it look more realistic. If you decide that you don't want to do that and you'd rather put them in after, or you just feel like it doesn't suit your style best, my favorite white highlight to use is the Sigma white gel pen. Again, that's linked down below, but I use it for the white highlights afterwards in all of my paintings where I decide I need to put something in, or I made a mistake and didn't leave enough white space. It's my favorite and it's super opaque. It's definitely like the best one I've found so far. And now I'm going in and I'm just taking a really small brush. It's a number 2. It's a round brush, but it has kind of a flat tip to it. And I'm just dabbing in these little darker areas. Since the oatmeal is going to have these little like fibrous bits to them and just this natural texture that shows through, I wanted to add that in there. And they're going to look darker when you first put them down, but they will eventually really lighten and look more natural over time. And while that was drying, I was just going in and darkening some of those little air bubbles that you can see down below. And then for the little chocolate pieces up top, I'm just adding a little bit more depth to them. I'm using the same burnt sienna, but I also added a little bit of sepia to make it a little bit darker. Now you'll see a lot of me increasing the contrast down below and along the sides of the jar. I really want to accentuate the curvature of the mason jar, and to do that I am making sure to do a lot along the sides of the jar and along the bottom. And you can see that on the left side of the jar I left this little bit of white space, or not necessarily like full white space, but areas that weren't completely blended out, so that I could create some contrast there and like a hot highlight later. And then for the spoon, I used the same mixture that I did for the oats, but a really light one like I did in the beginning, and I kind of exaggerate that a little bit further with a little bit more purple. And then I wanted to do the same with the chocolate portion up top and just add a little bit of texture. I felt like it really needed it. It was a little flat and I wanted to add a little bit of interest since it was such a large portion of this painting. And for the darker areas in the chocolate part where you have those little air bubbles, that swooped line up there, I'm just using sepia for that, and I'm kind of going in and making it a little bit darker as I go through and I add more glazes to that section. I wanted to make sure that they remain visible throughout the entire painting, but they did kind of get blended out and they lifted a little bit as I was going through. And now for the spoon, I'm going in again with that same mixture, but a little bit heavier on the dioxazine violet. And for some of the warmer areas of the spoon and the reflections of the spoon, I did add a little bit more of the yellow ochre, but I kind of stayed with that in that same mixture. It just looked more natural and it had this brassier look to it. It wasn't a completely silver spoon that I was painting, so it had this really nice kind of satiny matte finish to it. And I feel like it just looked really nice in the painting. And I'm just going in and darkening some of those shadows around the jar and around the bottom of the oats, and also in between the two layers. I wanted to make sure to get in some of those little tiny air pockets that would show up in there. And I also wanted to go in and take my mixtures for each segment and add a little bit more, because as you can see, the air bubbles that are very visible on top, they're not going to be the only air bubbles. So I wanted to add just a little bit of shadow that would make it look like there were air bubbles behind the layer that was touching the glass. So that's why I did that in the bottom and in the top. And I felt like that added both more texture and a more realistic look to the painting overall. And here you can see me doing that same thing with the chocolate layer up top, just adding a little bit more texture and something that would give the illusion that there is maybe more air pockets down below, or in the case of this top area, that maybe there were areas where like the chocolate wasn't as mixed in or something like that, just to really make it look handmade and not completely pristine. And then these final portions of the painting, I'm just going in and making sure that the contrast is how I would like it in all of the painting. And here you can see that I'm just adding burnt sienna with the dioxazine violet just to make that really dark, really up that contrast, doing the same thing down below, really adding a lot of contrast to the side of that jar because that is the side that is in the most shadow. And here you can see me going in with that little bit of white gel pen just to kind of accentuate some of the highlights. I didn't go overboard with any of this. I really just wanted it to look a little bit natural and to maybe highlight some of the areas that I felt like I had overpainted a little bit in my painting. And that is all for this week's video. I hope you enjoyed this painting and this tutorial. If you liked it, please give it a thumbs up or maybe a comment down below and let me know what you think. And if you have tried this painting on your own, then please tag me on social media. I would love to see it. And that is all for today. I will see you next time. Bye!